It is my duty, however, for I am sure you would not wish me to state the facts as I see them to you. It is my duty to place before you certain facts about the present position in Europe. From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow. Police governments, there is no truth. Turkey and Persia are both profoundly alarmed and disturbed at the claims which are being made upon them and at the pressure being exerted by the Moscow government. An attempt is being made by the Russians in Berlin to build up a quasi-communist party in their zone of occupied Germany by showing special favors to groups of left-wing German leaders. At the end of the fighting last June, the American and British armies withdrew westwards in accordance with an earlier agreement to a depth at some points of 150 miles upon a front of nearly 400 miles in order to allow our Russian allies to occupy this vast expanse of territory which the Western democracies had conquered. If now the Soviet government tries by separate action to build up a pro-communist Germany in their areas, this will cause new serious difficulties in the American and British zones and will give the defeated Germans the power of putting themselves up to auction between the Soviets and the Western democracies. Whatever conclusions may be drawn from these facts, and facts they are, this is certainly not the liberated Europe we fought to build up, nor is it one which contains the essentials of permanent peace. The safety of the world in Europe, from the quarrels of the strong parent races in Europe, that the world wars we have witnessed, or which occurred in former times, have sprung. Twice in our own lifetime, we have seen the United States against their wishes and their traditions, against arguments the force of which it is impossible, the force of which it is impossible not to comprehend. Twice we have seen them drawn by irresistible forces into these wars in time to secure the victory of the good cause, but only after frightful slaughter and devastation have occurred. Twice the United States has a strong France. All my public life I've worked for a strong France, and I never lost faith in our destiny, even in the darkest hours. I will not lose faith now. On the other hand, ladies and gentlemen, I repulse the idea that a new war is inevitable, still more that it is imminent. It is because I am sure that our fortunes are still in our hands, in our own hands, and that we hold the power to save the future, that I feel the duty to speak out now that I have the occasion and the opportunity to do so. Do not believe that Soviet Russia desires war. What they desire is the fruits of war and the indefinite expansion of their power and doctrines. But what we have to consider here today, while time remains, is the permanent prevention of war and the establishment of conditions of freedom and democracy as rapidly as possible in all countries. Our difficulties and dangers will not be removed by closing our eyes to them. They will not be removed by mere waiting to see what happens, nor will they be removed by a policy of appeasement. What is needed is a settlement, and the longer this is delayed, the more difficult it will be, and the greater our dangers will become. From what I have seen, there never was a war in history easier to prevent by timely action than the one which has just desolated such great areas of the globe. It could have been prevented, in my belief, without the firing of a single shot, and Germany might be powerful, prosperous, and honored today. But no one would listen. And one by one, we were all sucked into the awful whirlpool. And surely, ladies and gentlemen, I put it to you, surely we must not let that happen again. This can only be achieved by reaching now, in 1946, this year, 1946, by reaching a good understanding on all points with Russia under the general authority of the United Nations Organization, and by the maintenance of that good understanding through many peaceful years, by the world instrument, supported by the whole strength of the English-speaking world and all its connections. There is gentlemen, be wrong and imprudent to entrust the secret knowledge or experience of the atomic bomb which the United States, Great Britain, and Canada now share to the World Organization while it is still in its infancy. It would be criminal madness to cast it adrift in this still agitated and ununited world. Neither the sure prevention of war nor the continuous rise of world organization will be gained without what I have called the fraternal association of the English-speaking peoples. There is the path of wisdom. Prevention is better than cure.
President McClure, Governor Donnelly, ladies and gentlemen, you know, this is one of the greatest pleasures and privileges I have had since I have been President of the United States. Highly, Governor Donnelly's welcome to Mr. Churchill and myself. And I'm very thankful that Dr. McClure suggested from Mr. Churchill met Mr. Churchill. Mr. Churchill, he's one of the great men of the age. He's a great Englishman. He's a great Englishman, but he's half American. Mr. Churchill and I believe in, and it's one of the great privileges of my lifetime to be able to present to you
college this afternoon, and I am complimented that you should give me a degree from an institution whose reputation has been so solidly established. In fact, we have both been educated. It is also an honor, an opportunity. The President has told you that it is his wish, as I'm sure it is yours, that I should have full liberty to give my true and faithful counsel in these anxious and baffling times. Now, I shall certainly avail myself of this freedom and feel the more right to do so because any private ambitions I may have cherished in my younger days have been satisfied beyond my wildest dreams. Let me, however, make it clear that I have no official mission or status of any kind. I speak only for myself. There is nothing here but what you see. Ladies and gentlemen, the United States stands at this time at the pinnacle of world power. It is a solemn moment for the American democracy. For with primacy in power is also joined an awe-inspiring accountability to the future. If, as you look around you, you must feel not only the sense of duty done, but also you must feel anxiety lest you fall below the level of achievement. Opportunity is here now, clear and shining for both our countries. I trust that it may be done forthwith. The fear of them alone might easily have been used to enforce totalitarian systems upon the free democratic world with consequences appalling to human imagination. God has willed that this shall not be. And we have at least a breathing space to set our house in order before this peril has to be encountered. And even then, if no effort is spared, we should still possess so formidable a superiority as to impose effective deterrence upon its employment or threat of employment by others. Ultimately, when the essential brotherhood of man is truly embodied and expressed in a world organization with all the necessary practical safeguards to make it effective, these powers would naturally be confided to that world organization. Now I come
ist dort schon der Reichstag.
Dazu gar nichts beigetragen.
Attack is about to commence.
Parliament and press.
During these attacks, scores of peaceful citizens met unmerited. These things happened in the very heart of Piccadilly Circus itself. Did not into definite fact. The opinion of experts, the devastation at home and abroad, buildings smashed, towns demolished, millions.
Children. We love them all, the children, I mean. But cuddle, the people of Tooting show their public spirit by of 2,500 of their poorer kiddies seaside. If it were, the next stop, the seaside. The manip of the film editor scissors and we've arrived at Littlehampton. Cherish this glimpse of blue sea and...
Fortifié. Nouvelle stratégie de la guerre moderne. Les forts sont invisibles. Antichar. Ce sont les seuls. Par une armature de bois et d'acier, les forteresses, dont les ouvrages s'enfoncent profondément dans le sol, sont invulnérables à toute agression. C'est les vivres et des munitions, conduits les tunnels, une usine et une caserne. Transmis par l'intermédiaire de centraux têtes de boue s'équipent. Les différents permettent et transmettre immédiatement les grands navires de bataille en action. Les tirs combinés de ces pièces avec celui des mitrailleuses opposent un front de feu ininterrompu à l'avance de l'ennemi.
This nation will remain a neutral nation, but I cannot ask that every American remain neutral in thought as well. Even a neutral has a right to take account of facts. Even a neutral cannot be asked to close his mind or to close his conscience. I have said not once but many times that I have seen war and that I hate war. I say that again and again. I hope the United States will keep out of this war. I believe that it will. And I give you assurance and reassurance that every effort of your government will be directed toward that end. As long as it remains within my power to prevent, there will be no blackout of peace in the United States.
Seen in Brazil, were built and launched. New shipbuilding and dry dock company.
At the rapid expansion of totalitarian interests in Europe and Asia, President Truman addresses a joint session of Congress on our changing foreign policy. A grave gathering hears his forthright message.
The gravity of the situation which confronts the world today necessitates my appearance before a joint session of the Congress. The foreign policy and the national security of this country are involved. One aspect of the present situation, which I present to you at this time for your consideration and decision, concerns Greece and Turkey. The very existence of the Greek state is today threatened by the terrorist activities of several thousand armed men led by communists. I believe that it must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures. Should we fail to aid Greece and Turkey in this fateful hour, the effect will be far-reaching to the West as well as to the East. We must take immediate and resolute action. I therefore ask the Congress to provide authority for assistance to Greece and Turkey in the amount of $400 million for the period ending June 30th, 1948. In addition to funds, I ask the Congress to authorize the detail of American civilian and military personnel to Greece and Turkey at the request of those countries to assist in the tasks of reconstruction and for the purpose of supervising the use of such financial and material assistance as may be furnished. This is a serious course upon which we embark. I would not recommend it, except that the alternative is much more serious. The free peoples of the world look to us for support in maintaining their freedom. If we falter in our leadership, we may endanger the peace of the world, and we shall surely endanger the welfare of this nation. Great responsibilities have been placed upon us by the swift movement of events. I am confident that the Congress will face these responsibilities squarely.
It is my duty, however, for I am sure you would not wish me to state the facts as I see them to you. It is my duty to place before you certain facts about the present position in Europe. From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow.